Jakob Rossmann je mladi austrijski reditelj koji je više meseci sa svojom ekipom boravio u Lampeduzi radeći na dokumentarnom filmu o ovom mestu. Lampeduza sa svojih 5000 stanovnika je gradić na najjužnijem italijanskom ostrvu i godinama je prva tačka Evrope za izbeglice iz Afrike i sa Bliskog istoka. Poznat nam je najviše iz vesti koje se pojave kada se dese tragedije i ljudi sa izbegličkih brodova stradaju. Brosman je strpljivo sa svojom ekipom otkrivao tkivo života u ovom malom udaljenom mestu koje se bori sa svojim problemima, a nosi breme najvećeg humanog i političkog problema današnje Evrope. Film Lampeduza zimi nagrađen je na festivalima u Švajcarskoj, Španiji, u Beogradu, a u Austriji je proglašen za najbolji dokumentarac 2015. godine. Ovaj film i ekipu autora videli smo zahvaljujući festivalu Sedam veličanstvenih koji ih je ugostio u Beogradu.
Lampedusa is for 20 years the place that is the most confronted with the arrival of migrants. Since 20 years people are arriving on Lampedusa and we know the name from the media. We heard it 1,000 times everybody. We saw the picture of the boat overcrowded with migrants arriving, coming towards the camera all the time. And it was in 2011 where I started to be interested in that. And I was wondering all the time, what is there besides that picture of the boat with so many people on it? And so I wanted to find out this very small island with only 5,000 people, who is actually living there? How does it look when the people are actually touching the ground? What has it changed in the life of the people living there? So I started to search for something, but I could not find really the story or the information I was wondering about. So I went to find out, and what I found out was so different from what I expected that I wanted to share it with.
Oh, I saw it.
When I saw these pictures of so many people arriving and also the numbers, I had somehow the feeling that the life on the island must have come to an end. That you have to imagine, it's only 5,000 people and there is thousands, hundred thousands arriving in 1 year. So I had this expectation that maybe the life is really come towards an end of what it used to be, and also that there might be strong opinions against the refugees, some like racism or xenophobia. And when I arrived, it struck me, because it was kind of the different. There was a very normal life. It had not ended after 1 year of refugees coming, not after 2 years, not after 20 years. They continued their lives, and also they were not against the refugees. Most of the Lampedusani people see the refugees as victims that need people that need help. And I thought it might be a very interesting point to talk about to Europe, that a place that is really confronted every day continues on. And it has very, very many problems. Lampedusa has very many problems, but the refugees are not the biggest one most of the time.
Ma veramente, ma qua stiamo tornando a meno 50 anni fa, ma siamo ancora a questo livello veramente, una nave che ha fatto 50 anni fa per tre camion.
Ma perché il mio camion quando era già
figlio. Ora se noi consideriamo che ci sono due spazzature sempre fisse ogni giorno, due di nappite, che cosa imbarchiamo noi? Una buttiamo giù, ci sono la braga, me ne posso mandare tutta a capo, perché non posso fare? Perché là non potevo andare avanti con questa nave, siamo tutti morti, siamo di chiusura, tutta a casa.
There is a tradition of Lampedusani people fleeing Lampedusa for economic reasons and migrating to Africa. And there are also some small villages in Tunisia and Morocco where it's actually Italian people living until now. So he's talking about this wish of going away for economic reasons that has a big tradition. But of course, by now, there is war, especially there's a lot of conflicts also starting in Tunisia again. So it's a little bit contradictory, but it comes from this perspective of Italians leaving also in different directions.
Non si può questa nave da qualsiasi condizione da guardare un nodo, non si può.
Ci regalano le beneficenza. E così va a fare.
No, non può.
E portavo comunque facevo tutta beneficenza.
Most of the refugees don't know exactly about Lampedusa, about the situation there, of course. For them, Lampedusa is one step towards a life in dignity and safety. This is what they want, this is what Europe stands for them. Europe for them is dignity, the hope for dignity, the hope for safety, the hope for a self-decision, a life based on one's own decision. Because this is what Europe is telling outside and is telling to the world, okay, this is a place of freedom, a place of safety, a place of prosperous economy. So someone who is forced to flee his country of origin, is fleeing war, terror, and he's turning towards Europe, because there is also people turning towards Africa and fleeing somewhere to another country in Africa. So, but the people that are coming towards Europe, they expect to find freedom and safety. And Lampedusa is only one step for them. And for them it's a name, like for us it's a name. But when they arrive, some of them get to know the island, some of them don't, because they will be arrested and put behind razor wire the moment they arrive. And the Lampedusani people often told me that it's so sad that they cannot meet the people that are arriving. Only after some time, so if there start some problems with the authorities, the refugees start to break out of the center of the prison and go across the island and meet the Lampedusani people. So they can meet each other, and they started after the years to understand each other very well.
But it's not in our power to say to do something for you. We who live here in Lampedusa have no possibility to help you.
First and most impressive character that is also already known by now a little bit throughout Europe is Giusy Nicolini. She's the mayor of Lampedusa. She was elected, and no one was expecting that she would be elected, because Giusy is not from a common party. She just made her own list and run for mayor. And she's actually an environmental specialist. She's from Lampedusa, and she's very much in love with this island, because it's a very special place. It's a place where people came across for hundreds of years, and now the refugees on the way, on the try to reach safety, are coming also that direction. And she built up this environmental protection area on Lampedusa, and so to preserve the beauty of the island, which was not easy, because there is also a lot of greed. People want to make a lot of money in summer when the tourists arrive, and they don't respect the beauty of nature and destroy it for some money reasons. So she's fighting a lot of different fights for the future of the island, of the nature, also for the rights of the immigrants. But she's, on the same time, very powerless. She cannot even go to the refugee center without the permission. She has not a lot of things she can change about the political system and the way how Europe is treating the arriving migrants. At the same time, she has no power, but she does whatever she can, and even more, to talk about, to give people courage, because I believe it's very important to show and to explain that we don't need to be afraid, because there is so many fear. And I was happy to find Giusy, the mayor of Lampedusa, and that she was accepting us and the camera in all her difficult life, so we could show that there is no need to be afraid of the people coming from outside. Maybe we should be more afraid of how we are organizing our life and how we are respecting the poorest, not only the poorest refugees, but also the poorest Europeans.
Lampedusa non è responsabile delle leggi che sono in vigore e che li hanno costretti a fare violenza sul loro corpo per poter essere più liberi.
But Lampedusa is not responsible about these rules, about the law.
Paola was a great gift. To meet her was enriching, and I will carry that with me forever. Paola actually is not from Lampedusa. Paola is a person who decided to go to Lampedusa. She was an advocate, and she had a big career in Italy. And then on a certain point, she decided to change for a calm life on this island that she knew from her childhood, because she went there for holidays. And so she went there with her husband, and they built a small bed and breakfast. And then the refugees started to arrive more and more. And she told me, even the first night when she heard outside the rumor of arriving refugees, she was afraid and closed the doors and turned out the light. And then she thought, oh my God, what actually is happening? What am I doing? What am I afraid of? And she opened up and started helping. And this is what she does until that day. She's doing whatever she can to help. And sometimes you see in her face that it's also a lot of sadness that is coming, because the people that are arriving have suffered so much, and also a lot of them die on their way on trying to reach safety. So she's talking to media a lot also, she's writing, she's contacting politicians, and she's helping the very person that arrived at the same day.
Sapevamo anche prima del 3 ottobre che queste cose accadevano, che centinaia di persone morivano nel Mediterraneo, e per anni abbiamo sentito, parlo per me, ho sentito il dovere morale di raccontare, di parlare, di denunciare, e raccontavo.
For Paola, of course, it is also very hard, because she dedicated so much time of her life and so much energy to actually trying to change something, to warn Europe and to warn politics about the deadly consequences. But most of the people don't hear and don't react. And we have these ongoing situations with thousands, hundreds of thousands of victims. And there is no change to the better to see for the moment. And this is, of course, not easy, but what impressed me so much is that she did not give up. She started again. After every tragedy, after the shock and the grief, she said to herself, okay, I could not do it. I was not strong enough, but I will do again. And I know already that it's not enough. But I do it anyway.
Quando il 3 ottobre queste persone sono venute a morire qua, sotto i nostri occhi, lì mi è scattata una reazione che non avrei mai potuto prevedere. Cioè, io ho detto a tutti, perché venite a parlare con me adesso? Perché adesso?
This film, Lampedusa in Winter, is a film about Europe. It's a film about Europeans. The Lampedusani are Europeans. They are the first Europeans that are in contact with the refugees. But now a lot more Europeans are in contact with the refugees. And this is also a chance. It's a chance to understand that we don't need to be afraid, as Lampedusa shows us. We don't need to be afraid of the person who is arriving and asking for help. We should be afraid of our own system, of our own cynic politics, of our own cynic economy. We should be afraid of how we decide to treat each other. Because there is a lot of things going on before, outside our door, that we're not talking about. So many problems of Europe are not talked about, but everything is focused on so-called refugee problem. So, I wanted to dedicate this film to Europe. Europe is the continent of enlightenment. It's the continent of big art, big progress, big culture, so many different languages together, so many different cultures, so many progress and mindfulness and thought. But in the same time, Europe is war, endless row of war, endless row of crimes, a breeding area for racism. It conquered the world. It killed millions and millions of people all over. It's taking until now all the resources of certain places and forcing huge areas of the world to live in poverty. So Europe has the chance to be what it wants to be and what it's thinking about itself also. It really has the chance to be that for the world. It might be a safe port. It might be the light of reflection, the light of enlightenment, of solidarity also. But it's not. Not until now. The way people see the film changes, of course, a bit, depending on where are you from. If you are a European Union citizen, if you are from Schengen or Germany, Austria, it's a little different because you are part of the European system that is treating those people in that way. People outside Schengen, they see it a little different, but they might see it also a little bit clearer. But I was very happy to see that the film has also a universal language that is understood throughout several cultures. Not everything, of course, but a lot of things are understood very well. Like what does it mean to be a fisherman, to be afraid of losing the economic possibilities that one's life is based upon. This is a very huge topic, and also the topic that is inside the film of wanting to change something without having the power and fighting a fight that is very necessary but not very probable to win. So it's also not only a film about dignity, but also a film about losing. Because somehow they're all winning and they're all losing at the same time.
This, those who are friends or brothers, these are brothers especially. They are left.
The history of Austria is a history of refugees. Austria is a place where some of the worst crimes ever committed have been committed. Austria was a place that forced people to flee, that tried to kill people that could not flee and that actually killed people. And some of them also returned after what happened. And they, and the story of this part of history is still very much alive, even though some people don't want that to be that way. And in the same time, Austria also has a history of helping. And there came a lot of refugees, sometimes even more than now. For example, during the Hungarian crisis and during the Hungarian Revolution, there were over 160,000 refugees arriving in the very short period of some months. And Austria did help in a very good and dignified way and a coordinated way. And over the years, from every big crisis, Hungary, Czech Republic, Czechoslovakia it was back then, also Balkans, a lot of different people came to Austria, and actually it showed that we can do it, and actually it showed that it made our country and our culture stronger. It was not the end, like on Lampedusa. The arrival of something unknown is not the end, it's the beginning. It's a chance for something to improve, for something to get stronger. It's not the beginning of the end.
Wait, buddy, number two. One, two, three.
Three, you're going. All go. Right.
Hold tight.
Go, 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 go. Go.
Right. Hold tight.
Now we're talking all over Europe about fences, about limiting the refugee numbers, but the history shows us how deadly these decisions are. For example, Anne Frank, that might be very well known all over the world, she and her family asked for permission to go to the United States. And this permission was denied. It was denied shortly before she went into underground, before she went into hiding. And we all know how the story ends. And she's not the only one. It's millions of people that could have been rescued all over history, not only during the World War, the Shoah, the Holocaust. Millions of people could have been rescued. And if we start to fight for a more dignified way, if we start to show that we are not afraid, we will actually save people's lives. Not only by taking a person directly from Syria into my home, into my living room. This is not the only way to save a life. By talking to a politician, by talking to a friend, by explaining people that they don't need to be afraid, I'm also saving a little bit of life, and you too. I just always say that I don't want to live in a fortress, and I don't believe that we need to live in a fortress. We should focus our energy to a world, to build a world that don't need a fortress, Europe.
The place where you want your slave to go. Show me the place I've forgotten I don't know. Show me the place where my head is bending low. Show me the place where you want your slave.